Let us in. Stop.
Now, when you do, when you're in 2012, uh-huh. expect nominations from that for as an actor. Is that what you're looking for?
I would hope so. For 2012, yeah.
Genius work.
You mean the movie 2012 or the year?
Yes, the movie. Well, the movie becomes the year.
Yeah, exactly. I had a lot of fun doing 2012. Actually, I've never done a movie like that. It's such a trip.
You mean something that big and
just that ridiculously simple? Large, and you're on blue screen for 4 months, and it start. You feel like you're in a space program or something, where you come out of the time capsule because you're doing all your scenes and nothing's real. You have like half of a cliff or like a half of a kitchen or a picket fence, and everything else is blue. It's really, you know, it starts to freak everybody out, including the crew, I think.
Yeah, well, I think George Segal told a story about. Having, like, there was a set, I guess, that's on gimbals.
Yeah.
And the entire thing rolls.
Yeah.
And he said that was the strangest experience.
Yeah, that was kind of an intense scene, actually, yeah. Like, physically. But, yeah, we did a lot. I did a lot of flying in the movie, and we're always in these, like, planes that then they lift up and, you know, I had to keep... I had to keep reminding myself that, like, when I turned the plane, I didn't have to do this. The director would be like, you don't have to move or make noise.
You know,
we do that. Cusack in the back, like, what a rookie. Why am I working with this chump?
So is acting still fun the way it was?
I love it. I just don't have as much time to do it anymore. I mean, now I almost enjoy it more because when you're directing and especially writing and directing, you're so completely engrossed that it's tough to kind of kick back and have fun. You know, mm-hmm. You're kind of all about getting the work done. There's still enjoyable moments, and I have the luxury of working with a lot of good people, including my actors. But, you know, it's very different than acting when you're there to do your one job.
Yeah. So you now it's kind of like that's a vacation.
It does feel like that a little bit. Yeah, especially when you're on those big movies where you're like, wow, this trailer is bigger than my apartment. It does feel a little bit easy, you know. And it's not. Acting's a really difficult thing. And the toughest thing an actor has to do, I think, is remain focused. Because it's very easy to let that slip, even by degrees. And with, you know, I think really great performances, that is the challenge to maintain that. But that said, that's the one thing they're there to do.
Yeah. So where did Win-Win start for you?
Win-Win started with a funny conversation with Joe Taboni, who developed a story with me about high school wrestling. We were both high school wrestlers on the same team growing up together. And
different weight classes, I think?
Yeah, he was a little heavier than me. I was actually I wrestled 101 and 108.
Wow.
Yeah, I was a killer. And we were just talking about how bad we were. And finally, going into my senior year, I was like, you know what? I'm going to stop now because we don't have to do this if we don't like it. And he's like, he had this whole mentality of like, we have to see it through, and had a miserable senior year, just got demolished. And we look back, I'm like, why didn't you just quit with me? Why didn't you take a break? And he's like, I don't know, I wish I did. But it started with that conversation. And
wrestling is kind of the worst thing to get stuck in. Like
when you're bad at wrestling.
It's really not fun.
No. Yeah. I mean, if you're bad at basketball, you don't make shots and people run past you.
Right.
You know, baseball, you sit out in the field and you get bored, or you sit in the dugout. But wrestling, you literally just get the crap kicked out of you. And
I remember the smell of armpits.
Yeah, you got guys you don't like just mushing your face into the mat and putting legs all over you. And it's just like, it is completely humiliating.
Yeah.
There's something great about the sport. And making the movie made me appreciate it all over again. And, you know, especially if you're as good as Alex or as Kyle is in the movie, that's a whole other level, like anything in life. There's a certain enjoyment with that. But we definitely had a lot of fun kind of jumping back in and doing the research and going to high school matches. And I mean, it's just such a weird little subculture. Even in the high school sports world, it's a weird subculture.
Yeah.
You know, because it's like the bastard sport. It's the backroom sport at most schools. You know, it's not your football or your tennis or even your basketball or your baseball or your even tennis and soccer kind of second tier. Wrestling is it's the sport that dare not speak its name, you know. But
you read a lot of John Irving in the process, or you...
I didn't. I've read in the past, but no, I didn't in prep for this. I felt like I had a pretty good fix on the wrestling, having done it and then having spent an inordinate amount of time going to tournaments and matches and practices. And you know, it's kind of weird to be walking around at my age and just watching wrestling all the time. You start to feel a little strange after a while.
Get a phone call.
Yeah. We literally, I was with my cinematographer who's German, and we were at this meet, and we're kind of walking around the mat, and he's pulling out camera, and finally this guy just comes over, and he's like, who the hell are you guys? You need to leave. You need to leave the gymnasium right now.
God.
And then we explained we were movie people, and then they threw us out. No, but it is kind of, it was a funny place to spend a winter kind of kicking around those old gyms.
So to the structure of the story, obviously, is...
Yeah, that was another issue. You know, that was its own process where the wrestling was kind of a, like all ideas, like, oh, that's a great idea, and then you actually have to execute it or discover it, as was the case with this film. But it definitely started with this impulse of like, wow, high school wrestling, and then thinking more about it, and then witnessing it. And then while I was doing this, I was spending a lot of time with Joe, who is a small-town elder law attorney. And that has always been interesting to me, like a guy his age who spends all his time with people 80 and above and confronting some very real issues, but it's kind of, it can be both a very dramatic and funny job because of his clientele. And we would talk a lot about that over the years, his clients and what that was like. And I started to think about that in the context of where we're at. And there was a lot of focus at that time, 3 or 4 years ago, on the ills of Wall Street and how these big problems by big important people. And you know, I sort of became interested in the fact that, you know, a lot of these people who are so, have done all these bad things, they're decent people in their communities, in their families, they're our neighbors. We know a lot of these people, the really rich ones we don't all know, but we know a lot of them who contributed to this problem. And that suddenly became very interesting to me, like good people who make bad choices in a really simple way. You know, and I realized I was kind of jumping into unsensational territory of small town suburban America and high school wrestling. It doesn't speak to like, wow, the gritty, you know. It was like I was dealing with like a pretty happy middle class and it just wasn't working anymore. And that early on took on its own challenge. I was like, can I make this compelling? Can I find something in here that without commenting on the world, you know, without sensationalizing it or satirizing it or condescending to it or just, you know, sentimentalizing it, but just really just presenting it and saying, this is really how I see this place. Is there drama in here? Is there something to explore? And I think that was always the biggest, for me, challenge and concern with Win-Win.
Have you started in that place with the other films? Have you started anything where this is a landscape that I want to show, and then I'm adding all the other pieces?
I think whenever, but all these stories, the three films, Station Agent, A Visitor, and Win-Win, they always kind of come together in pieces, right? And you start to, I rarely have a thunderbolt of, man, I need to make a movie about capitalism, or I need to make a movie about, you know, it's, I like stories that feel like they're cobbled together in the same way life is cobbled together. When you think about your life, it's rarely about one thing, hopefully. I like those stories that how do high school wrestling and elder law fit? And in some weird way, it did for me very early on. So I could see how this would work for this guy. Yeah. Even becoming a coach made sense to me because it was, you know, this guy a few years earlier is a little more flush and he thought, I'm going to give something back. And, you know, it's also going to ingratiate me to the community and their parents will be my clients. And it all sort of makes sense in a small town business model. And we were really able to justify that. And those decisions are important because if it's just, you know, if he just is a wrestling coach for the sake of being one, then that doesn't quite work. Doesn't feel organic.
He's Chico's bail buns.
Exactly. Exactly. So, you know, and that is both for me, the fun exploration in the screenwriting process. And, you know, again, I'm not pulling from source material. I'm not adapting. I'm coming up, you know, these are original screenplays, obviously. And I think that sort of discovery is, it's a very enjoyable part of the process because inevitably after some time, these ideas do start to coalesce. They do start to kind of feed off each other.
So how do you know when to stop with a screenplay and get onto the part where you're actually going to start casting and thinking about it?
You know, I'm a big rewriter. I believe in revision, and I do that quite a bit. But you start to get to a point where just large segments of the screenplay are really working, and you feel like I've conquered most of these things. There's still some smaller transitional questions or maybe thematic questions, or, you know, there's some characters I still have to find. And when I feel like I've reached that point, that I feel like the screenplay is 90% there after a number of passes, I'll start to move into the next phase, which is really thinking about the actors, if I haven't already. And this, you know, usually I've thought about a few actors at that point, mm-hmm. but really starting to put the movie together. And you know, I rely on the people I work with to kind of give it to them. And so, like, I'm ready to move forward with this.
Are you writing on spec, or are you?
I always write on spec. Yeah, I have with these three films because. Look, I've made three movies. I'm still figuring it out. It's a process. It's like, you know, it's funny. I think before most actors really become, you know, except for those rare occasions, but by the time they really start to establish themselves, they've done so much, mm-hmm. usually in the theater or small films or TV or this, so much before they really, no one knows who the hell they are.
Right.
And they're like, wow, this person, and you realize there's a experience and craft behind it to some extent. And I think with filmmaking, it's a tough thing, right? Because it's a big stage and it's an expensive stage. Even with small films, yeah. it's still somebody's $500,000 or someone's $3 million or someone's $8 million. It's still money. You know, for me, it has been a real process. And I think the writing and this, what we're talking about right now, it's always been my in. It's been my in to kind of understanding it, you know, and wrapping my mind around it and starting to feel the film and you know, I guess it's the process.
So did you imagine any of this cast in the movie before while you were writing?
Yeah, I did. Paul and Amy and Bobby pretty early on. Paul, you know, I've wanted to work with Paul forever. We went to school together. I've just outside of being a friend of his, you know, a huge fan of his work and the body of his work. And I just, you know, he's just one of those actors that is always honest. You just believe whatever comes out of the guy's mouth, whatever period or place or character, you kind of believe it. And I think when I thought, I really felt like I needed to finish the screenplay before I talked to Paul about it. Mm-hmm. And I needed to consider other actors for the roles. There's so many good actors out there. And I felt like, you know, when I kind of narrowed down that Paul was in the right, that he his type of person is the right type for this, then it was an easy decision. You know, I realized I could hear his voice. I had been hearing his voice. Mm-hmm. Even Joe, and this was Joe's first screenplay, was like, I always kind of could hear his voice. Is that weird? I'm like, no, that makes sense. And same with Amy Ryan. I had her Amy in mind from early on, and Bobby Cannavale.
Well, the funny thing is, I mean, one of the things that's amazing about the film is that Amy and Paul feel like they've been together for a million years. I mean, they really.
Yeah.
My first thing was like they should be doing Nick and Nora movies together.
Right. Yeah.
Because you could see them together playing off of each other comfortably anytime, anywhere. It'd be fun to watch.
Yeah, it was real, and I've known them both individually for a long time, and I don't think they'd ever met before Win-Win. Now, I brought them in early to do some rehearsals and get them talking, and they actually tell a funny story about their first walk home from rehearsal. Like, they're like, we didn't talk to each other for the first six blocks because we were both nervous. I was like, come on, you guys, you're like pros, you know? And they're like, she's like, I know, but I didn't know. He got really awkward, and then they broke through that pretty quickly. But yeah, that is one of those things where you're like, oh yeah, this works. Like right away, you could kind of just see the chemistry of not just two really great actors, but two people who connected and felt like they were of the world. And I think some of that was just in getting the right casting. You know, I think when you see these guys, you believe, yeah, they strike me as that couple. You know, that love each other and that are really good partners, but are struggling. You know, it's hard. It's hard work.
But even with good actors, you don't often see that degree of.
Yeah.
It's just like a worn-in shoe between the two of them.
Yeah.
It just felt great.
Yeah, and I think they really like each other. Yeah. And look, I think Jackie and Mike really like each other. I think Paul and Amy really liked each other and respected each other. And I think respect is probably a good word there and a good word to use for that couple because I think that is the great disappointment in the movie that respect is really damaged. I think, you know, Jackie really has to look at this guy and be like, the hell is he doing?
So you wrote her to be respected. I mean, she's a really strong character.
Yeah, yeah. She's
you don't
tough...
see them for women very often on the screen. And
You know, I felt like she's like a lot of the women that I grew up with in New Jersey, this kind of tough Irish Catholic kind of like, they can be fiercely judgmental and then fiercely inclusive and protective. You know, it's that kind of clan mentality of maybe not just letting people in so easily, but when they do, they're in. Mm-hmm. And they'll do whatever they have to take care of someone. And I think Amy, being a good Queens girl and a good Irish woman, just got that. She really connected with that early on.
And Alex is kind of the find of the one of the finds of the year, really.
Yeah, man, that's such a, you know, that is one of those, no matter how confident you feel in your casting ability, when you're taking on someone, especially with a cast like we were assembling, and then take on this kid that you think, whoop, do we...
Are
you still going? You know, you take on this kid that has never done anything, and you know, he came in and he was what he is, which was a great wrestler, you know, and he was a kid who was very specialized in his life. He went to mm-hmm. school so he could wrestle. Everything was about wrestling his whole life, and you know, as it turned out, he won the state championship the year that we, you know, 2 weeks after we cast him in Win-Win, which was just so bizarre. But that's who the kid was. Like, he was really mm-hmm. defined. Like, I played sports my whole life, or tried to in some cases, but it was never defined me. Very few of us are like that in our young lives. But some of those rare athletes, they are, because they're so good and they've become so specialized, and he was mm-hmm. like that. But, you know, I think there was something just right about him for the role as in who Alex is and was at that time. The trick was, and the worry was, can we get him there in terms of performance opposite Paul and Amy and these really good actors he was working with? And, you know, to his credit, what made it work is I think he applied many of the things that made him a great wrestler to making the performance work, which was he's kind of fearless and weirdly self-assured without being cocky. He just wanted to keep getting better and working. Mm-hmm. And he would just, and he worked very hard offset. He went, you know, took these classes with his acting coach, Jackie Brogan, and just like really stepped up. He'd never done any of this. This wasn't mm-hmm. like taking an actor and be like, you got to work hard now. It was like taking a kid who'd never done it and being like, okay, that's a camera. Mm-hmm. That's new. This is a set. All these people are going to get really quiet when you talk. This is a mic. You know, it's a lot. For a person to take in, especially considering, you know, 3 weeks before we cast him, he'd never had any desire, yeah. you know, to be an actor, or had not pursued it in any way.
So how did you find him if he wasn't?
You know, we did a huge casting call. Mm-hmm. Kerry Barden, my casting director, and his team, I just said, look, I know this is a big thing to impose on this character, but I think we really need a wrestler. Mm-hmm. I think the way I want to shoot it, and you know, I don't want to cut around some kid. I have to teach the kid. And, you know, the first time I see him moving in the movie, wrestlers, great wrestlers, you know, it's like boxers. You know, if I mm-hmm. act like a boxer, I look like I'm out of the 1910, you know. But I needed a kid who could be cat-like and move like that, which mm-hmm. Alex does. And they sort of did a tri-state. they looked everywhere, but really focused on in the sort of the tri-state area. And all these kids came in. As even Alex said, a buddy of his texted him and said, you should do this. And he's like, nah. And then he said, my friend said, hey, it's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. And he said, yeah, you're okay. So he came in, you know. It's so funny. That's how we all are at 16. Mm. You know, nah, okay, I'll do that. All right, yeah. Just kind of floating along. And luckily, he came in. And even that, it wasn't like, we found him.
Right.
It was like, wow, this kid's unique. Let's have him in again, and let's have him in again, and let's have him in again. Why don't you go work with Jackie, and can you come back in again? Mm-hmm. You know, God bless his parents for bringing him in 7 or 8 times from New Jersey and sitting in the waiting room as we worked with him. But, you know, finally I had him meeting with Paul and Amy, and it was clear that he could get there.
So was the character very different than the kid? In terms of
tone? I mean, a little bit. I mean, I think Alex can be a little bit, more engaged than Kyle is in the movie. But they definitely both have that laid back kind of surf punk, where is this kid from? Is he from the Valley or Oklahoma or New Jersey? Mm-hmm. You know, who is this kid? They both have that. Even Alex, for being such a great wrestler, is so reserved. I mean, you'd think he's going to fall asleep at any moment. He just seems detached. But mm-hmm. then when he's on the mat, he comes alive, you know? And I think there was something that I liked about that in terms of this character. I didn't want you to see him and think, wow, this kid's a stud. I wanted you to think this kid's he's a very unique young man. Yeah. And Alex, even in the wrestling world in New Jersey, was already known as that, as being a sort of unusual star athlete.
He sounds like the Sam Shepard of the rape stuff.
Exactly. It was just like, what is it?
Piece of gum.
Yeah. Like, you know, and it's you couldn't. I mean, he came in with his hair like that. You mm-hmm. know, that it was that dyed, not even dyed. It was just bleached. They literally just poured bleach on their heads in a fit of 16-year-old intelligence. The team got together and bleached out. You know, but that kind of thing, you know, and he came in, he like had like pajama bottoms and slippers and his bleached hair and his headphones. And I was like, all right, this feels starting to feel right, mm-hmm. you know. So he made that, you know, and I think it was one of those times where what was on the page. And probably I did some work on it once I met him, but it was already, there was a real connection between the person and the character at that point.
So more interesting to manage him or Burt Young?
That's a toss-up. That is a toss-up. Two very different things. You know, it's Burt Young, you know. As soon as we had the idea to cast Burt, and I said that because I was kind of sitting around with Bobby and Paul one day and being like, who is our Leo? And we were just, you know, rifling through all the great older actors out there right now, and there's so many of them. And then Burt popped into our head, and we're kind of like, huh. And the next day I sat down with him, and that was kind of it. He kind of won me over. But he's challenging, you know. He's not an actor who suffers fools or really anyone gladly, including directors. And, you know, sometimes I'd give him a harmless note and he'd be like, ah. You know, I'd be like, does that mean yes or no? And, but what you get with Burt is he's always ready to go. Mm-hmm. He's always prepared and he's going to give you a lot. He gives you a lot of range, and sometimes it's tough to see on set because it's his method. It's there is method, and you know he just happens to be a very, very talented actor.
Well, it's interesting. I mean, it's one of your trademarks, I guess, to break cliche and to, you know, take things that we expect one thing from and to give us something unexpected. And I think that's why people love your movies, in part. So, you know, with Dinklage, obviously a whole different animal than expected. Yeah. In this movie, Burt Young is an incredible surprise because there is an interesting thing going on there, and it's kind of thrilling to see him again doing something that's actually challenging and weird. And
yeah, that is a really tough performance. I mean, trying to play someone who's battling those early stages of dementia and couple that with what is probably a cagey character to begin with. You know, he's kind of always got that look in his eyes. So it's that.
You're always like waiting for him to go way over the top.
Yeah, yeah.
And somehow he doesn't hear
you. Yeah. Know? And sometimes he would.
Yeah.
Sometimes he would do takes where you're like, whoa, all right, let's try that. You know, and it was great. I mean, and sometimes we would use elements of that where he would just get really upset. And there's something about that in the character about that, those kind of swings where he get very violent over an idea because he wouldn't understand that the judge on TV wasn't the real judge. And you see people working and grappling with that. And there's also something of there suddenly these real moments of lucidity. And then these kind of, you know, this is a guy, and I think who really made his own way in the world. And was he always the greatest dad? I would guess probably not in this movie. But, you know, you kind of see all sides. I think Burt, you know, considering he's not on screen that much, like he really brings such a fully realized character to the screen. When you see him, you know him, you know, and he kind of breaks your heart by the end, or at least didn't for me. It's just really touching.
So when you're on set, how much of a writer are you? Do you have to drop some of that to
deal? I try. By the time I'm set, I try to be pretty locked down. I mean, look, sometimes things happen. You have to adjust because the scene's not working, or the location isn't working, or suddenly, let's move this. This shouldn't be here, and I need to adjust a little bit. Or or there's just a discovery where, like, you know, we haven't said this, or this we've said this before. This doesn't feel right. So, you know, I think it's good then that I am a writer and I am available. But directing is enough of a job where I'm trying to ignore the writer a little bit, like I would if there was a writer there, because, you know, writers always want to get it just right, and I'm not sure there is anything as just right. I think if you're always going for what's just right, it can come out a little flat and canned and stale. So I think it is just trusting the work that's done. I mean, we do spend some time in rehearsal with the actors, and that's not just for performance. It's really to try to answer and correct any and all problems on the script at the script phase. So by the time we're set, hopefully we've done all that work, but sometimes you can't avoid it.
And as a director, how hands-on are you? The actors, are you?
It really depends what actors need. I mean, again, I expect actors to be prepared. I've had the good fortune of working with a lot of very good actors.
Exactly. They made choices.
Well, they could say no.
But I mean, that's like Hitchcock always said, it's, you know, the casting.
Yeah.
You know, it is. I mean, you bring the right people on.
Exactly, and they do the work for you. And, you know, you get there, and sometimes it's just, sometimes like anyone, like an athlete, they need, you know, see great athletes who sometimes really need a coach. Sometimes the best thing the coach can do is just stay out of the way and let the athlete do his thing, and actors the same. Sometimes they just need to know you're there, and they can just be. And that if they go too far off the map, you're there to bring them back on. And sometimes, you know, you need to figure things out a little bit more. So it really is a case-by-case basis. But, you know, usually I find once we get rolling, they make my job easy.
And does it doesn't sound like you find the movie in post like some directors do. It sounds like you kind of
there's always know where elements. Yeah, no, I you know I have to. I'm as much that's as much a process for me as anything, and it's incredibly humbling. Scenes that you killed yourself to try to get right, you see, like that is just not working, mm-hmm. and it's nobody's fault but mine. Yeah, it's a great performance. Or there's some really scenes that are really well realized, even with that. There's some scenes that didn't make the movie that just they don't fit in the final equation just mm-hmm. because of how the you know that next stage the movie takes on a life of its own. So you know you're always finding it in different ways, and sometimes you're discovering new elements that you're like, oh, this is a really exciting that this is kind of bubbling up now and it's really mm-hmm. operating. And sometimes you don't know that until you hear it back from people. You're like you sit and you do these small screenings and you listen to people talk afterwards. And I literally do that in my edit room with 9 to 10 people. And sometimes the things that just the early response you get from people is so incredibly helpful.
So are any of the three movies more post focused than the others, or is
no? Pretty even? No, I think it's pretty even. I think The Station Agent. I was struggling more with finding that narrative because it was so lacking in terms of like an antagonist, you know, mm-hmm. and that sort of, and there wasn't really a great external pressure. And I was lucky enough to have Sidney Lumet come to the edit room mm-hmm. and watch it and just kind of sit us down, me and my editor Tom McCardle, and talk to us for a couple hours and really challenge us mm-hmm. to find this sort of. To find our kind of tent poles for the movie, our moments where we'd say, where does this movie, where does mm-hmm. this, you know, where does the story hang on? And he really helped us find the movie. And that was a big lesson for me.
So how does Sidney Lumet end up in your cutting room?
Well, I knew Sidney because he was Bobby Cannavale's father-in-law. Because one time Bobby used to be married to Jenny Lumet, yeah. and they still stayed very close. And you know, I would talk to Sid. You know, I was getting ready to make the movie, and he was generous enough to let me sit in his office and ask all the stupid questions that we need to ask. and then I called him one day, and I was like, you know, I'd love to show you. Can I bring a DVD? And oh, now where are you? Okay, I'll come down tomorrow. You know, I'll see you then. 8 a.m. We're like 8 a.m. Who comes? Who watches a movie at 8 a.m.? And my editor, I remember we hung up. My editor's like, I guess we should clean up, right? Because we had this like crappy little edit room. It wasn't even an edit room. I don't know what it was, but and I was like, yeah, but I'm pretty sure Sid have seen it all at this point, right? And came in and just powered through the movie and then sat us down and yeah, you know, just like a master filmmaker can really kind of got right to the. And he was incredibly gracious about it. You know, he wasn't like, this is what you got to do to fix it. He's like, here are the problems, or here's what I'm mm-hmm. not understanding. And he raised all the right questions.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Those guys always seem like, you know, deities or something after you, I mean, a little closer to you than to me, obviously.
Yeah. But,
you know, you study them and you see their films and you watch their films over and over again, and then it's still a person, you know?
It's so true. And I find with the, you know, I've had the good fortune to work with some very good filmmakers and guys who've made a lot of movies and seen them work up close, but the best guys are—they're just guys who love doing what they do, and they take it seriously, and they work yeah. hard, and they want to work with good people. And there has definitely, at least in my experience, been the people whose films I've liked the most have turned out to be some pretty decent people and incredibly generous people. And Sid was mm-hmm. was a real mensch. Took it seriously, and he was a no bullshit guy. But man, he loved to get into it.
Yeah. So was Sundance the first time you saw this in front of a real audience?
Yeah.
So it was. Is that a nerve-wracking
it
moment
always
for you?
Is, yeah. And they think, I've been to Sundance 3 times, it's their movie, and I could kind of feel like it was working to some extent, but, you know, it's just never easy.
So did you stay in the room and watch?
I did. I sat there with some of my cast, and I said, let's just get through this together, and then we'll go have a drink. And, you know, fortunately, we had a good response to the movie, and you could kind of feel the audience. You know, it was a good movie for Sundance, I think, and for those opening weekend at Eccles. And, mm-hmm. You know, but that is, it's just not easy. You know, you care too much, you work too hard, you have too many people involved who have given a lot to it. And I think, you know, speaking personally, you feel a fair amount of responsibility to that.
So did you know you had them? when you were doing it? I was in the room, so I guess.
You can kind of feel it, you know? And look, even, it's funny because I came back the next morning at like 9:30, 10 in the morning, and I would venture to guess, I got there maybe halfway through, that it was a more connected screening. Because I think whenever you have your premiere screenings, you're open, you've been to enough of them, there's always that other energy in the room, you know? There's all the industry, there's all this stuff. So when there's all that going on, that can't not help but dissipate what you're there to do, which is get lost in a movie. Like that really, this isn't that hard. We're there to get lost. And I like nothing more. But I know if I'm sitting in a seat and I'm vibrating with nervousness and watching and listening and hearing, I'm not this, you know? And pretty much everyone is doing that on some level because they're like, oh, they're into it. Oh, this is going well. Or, you know, you're all about that as opposed to just sitting down with a cup of coffee at 10 in the morning and getting lost, you know? And so that's the one downside, I think, to premieres and those opening nights is there's all that other energy. I mean, it's exciting and all those other things. But for me, the best experience is just when you are sitting with an audience who's just there to do one thing, see a movie and nothing else and get lost in it. And I do like doing that when I have the chance.
So this movie opened just a couple months after Sundance, or not even months, I think 6 weeks or something.
Yeah.
And now you're talking to us, but in general, the movie's now been around for a while. Do you disconnect and move on to the next thing and start working immediately?
Yeah. I mean, you know, you have to go, you know, the movie was out for a long time. Then you go to Europe and do the press there, and then you do the press junket running around this country, like a vacuum cleaner salesman or something, you know, city by city. So you have to do that, and I understand that responsibility, but it is a lot. And by the time you're done with it, you really don't ever want to talk about your movie or yourself again for a long time. And the nice part about the whole process for me is there's when I feel like I've done, and I've done everything I said I had agreed to do and all these interviews and everything, I love then disappearing and getting back into the writing room and just not talking. You know, just reading and watching movies and writing again, like that is a really enjoyable part of the process. And I've been doing that all summer and couldn't be happier. So yeah, it's a little funny to kind of be back here and talking about the movie, but this isn't the first movie that I've had come out that's opened up in the spring and then you have to go back at the end of the year, hopefully, and people want to talk about it. It's a good thing they do. It's definitely odd to be revisiting.
Well, will you watch the movie again? Have you watched the movie since?
I haven't.
Spring?
No. I can't really do it anymore.
Do you watch any of the movies over?
No.
You know,
I recently went to speak. This was funny. I went to speak at NYU, just to the film school there, and they for some reason they showed the three trailers, which I thought was so funny for film students. Because I'm like, well, don't worry about trailers. It's got nothing to do with what we do. But that's all they had, and they just wanted to give a taste of the movies or something. And it was very odd to see the three trailers back by back. And then you start to think about people like Sydney and these people who have made 34. I'm like, what must that feel like to look back on that? But I do feel like those movies are to be looked back on at some point. And for me right now, I just want to kind of move on and do something new.